Would you turn with me in your Bibles to Exodus chapter 18? Exodus chapter 18. We're going to pick up in verse 13 this morning. Exodus chapter 18, verse 13. Now as you're turning, we got three sermons left in Exodus, and we're going to preach through the Lord's Prayer. That'll be fun. But let me catch you up to where we're at right now. Israel has left the land of slavery, and they're headed to the land of promise. We find ourselves in an analogous situation. We are on a journey. And do you know what God tells Israel that they need? Do you know what God says that we need? Don't throw rocks at me. Government. That's a taboo word these days. God says that we need government. The Christian life is not meant to be lived alone. It is meant to be lived in the context of a church, of a covenant community. And anytime you put a group of people together, there will always be a leader. But we need more than a leader. We need leaders, godly leaders, to share this burden together. So let's pick up that thought in our sermon in a sentence. Don't bear the load, share the load. Don't bear the load, share the load. Let's pray and we'll jump in. Heavenly Father, You have given us Your Word to build us up in holiness and comfort, to be useful means unto our salvation. I pray that for the next time that we would attend Your Word with diligence, preparation, and prayer, that we would receive it in faith and love, that we'd lay it up in our hearts and practice it in our lives. By the power of Your Spirit, may it be so. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. We're going to pick up at verse 13. Hear the word of the Lord. The next day, Moses sat to judge the people. And the people stood around Moses from morning until evening. When Moses' father-in-law saw all that he was doing for the people, he said, "What is this? What is this that you are doing for all the people? Why do you sit alone? And all the people stand around you from morning till evening." And Moses said to his father-in-law, "Because the people come to me to inquire of God. And when they have a dispute, they come to me and I decide between one person and another. And I make them know the statutes of God and His laws." And Moses' father-in-law said to him, "What you are doing is not good. You and the people with you will certainly wear yourselves out, for the thing is too heavy for you. You are not able to do it alone. Now obey my voice, and I will give you advice, and God be with you. You shall present the people before God, or you shall represent the people before God and bring their cases to God. And you shall warn them about the statutes and the laws, and to make them know the way in which they must walk and what they must do. Moreover, look for able men from all the people, men who fear God, who are trustworthy and hate a bribe, and place such men over the people as chiefs of thousands, of hundreds, of fifties and tens. Let them judge the people at all times. Every great matter they shall bring to you, but any small matter they shall decide for themselves. So it will be easier for you, and they will bear the burden with you. If you do this, God will direct you, and you will be able to endure. And all this people also will go to their place in peace." So Moses listened to the voice of his father-in-law and did all that he had said. Moses chose able men out of all of Israel and made them heads over the people, chiefs of thousands, of hundreds, of fifties, and of tens. They judged the people at all times. Any hard case they brought to Moses, but any small matter they decided themselves. Then Moses let his father-in-law depart, and he went away to his own country. Thus ends the reading of God's word this morning. When I was younger, I worked for an older man, Mr. Richard. Mr. Richard was a GP man. He ran a pulpwood, the pulpwood division. He knew how to work. But Richard had a famous line. He would look at his young employees and he would say, "Boys, my back hurts." And they'd say, "Why's that, Mr. Richard?" "From carrying all your weight around." We get exactly what he's trying to say, isn't he? He's the lone pillar. He's bearing the greatest burden. Do you know what happens when a post bears too much weight? It cracks. Do you know what happens when a man bears too much weight? He screams. And everyone else suffers for it. We are not made to bear this life alone. We must share the load. Now let's look at our text. We have a covenant community. We might say we have a church. Look at the church today. Too many times it lacks peace. Not because there's too much going on, but because there's not enough going on. There's not enough leaders to support the activity. Rank injustice occurs and needs go unmet. Peace dissolves because there's not enough leaders to bear the burden. Pastors burn out. Opportunities for growth go unnoticed because there's not enough pillars to support the expansion. Do you think God is concerned with expansion? Do you think God is concerned with peace? Do you think God is concerned with our load? God sends Jethro, Moses' father-in-law, and he looks at him very plainly and he says, "Moses, what you're doing is not good. You cannot bear the load alone. You must share the load." So let's pick up that statement this morning. Don't bear the load. Share the load. Let's ask two questions. What load are we bearing? And who will we share it with? What are we bearing? And who will we share? Well, what's the load Moses is bearing? All the people have problems. We live in Raymond. What's the population of Raymond? It's pretty small. There's lots of problems. Now try 600,000 people. There might be a couple more. And everybody brings their problem to Moses. Moses is the one that has to deal with it. You might say Moses is suffering from what I like to call the Messiah complex. Have you ever had the Messiah complex? Let me read its symptoms to you. Hard work ethic, ability to get things done, dependable. Those sound good, don't they? Let's keep going. Work overload, inability to defer, absence of the word no from our vocabulary, anxiety, frustration, exhaustion, and as a result, we suffer spiritual and physical health declines. This is a Messiah complex. Now we understand what Moses might be thinking, don't we? I mean, who can do what Moses can do? He's the man. He's the one in charge. He knows how things operate around here. But you know what someone once told me? Graveyards are full of irreplaceable men. Elijah had to learn this lesson the hard way. Elijah goes up Mount Carmel. He lays a smackdown on 450 prophets of Baal. Jezebel comes and says, "Elijah, I'm going to get you." And Elijah runs. Why does he run? Well, he comes to the mountain of God. He meets God, and what's the first thing out of his mouth? "God, I'm the only one left." Ding, ding, ding. Elijah is suffering from the Messiah complex. Elijah and Moses cannot bear the load alone. Now I look in this room. Many of us are tired. We get worked up about little, and we're worn down over much. For some of us, it's pride. No one can do it like I can do it. Sometimes it's the inability to trust. Well, I don't know if they'll get the job done. But most of the time, well, we're good old Southern folk. We don't like to ask for help. I'm the man of the house. I'm a leader. I shouldn't ask for help. Or my favorite Southern expression, you know, you say, "Can I give you a hand?" "Oh no, I don't want to be a burden." How many times have we heard that one? It's the inability. It's the Messiah complex. And for those of us content with living on the fringes, for those who are hit or miss on Sundays, for those who like to fly solo through life, you're suffering from the Messiah complex. What you're saying is, "God, I only need a little help. I can do the rest on my own." D.A. Carson tells a story about this young couple driving through the Midwest, and they see this beautiful Cadillac broke down on the side of the road. They pull over, and the man had a business meeting he had to get to, and he didn't stop for gas. So they give him a gallon of gas, he pours it in the tank, and they say, "You know, there's a service station up the road." Well, they stop and eat. And as they get back on the highway, guess what they see? They see a beautiful Cadillac on the side of the road. It was the same man. My meeting is too important. I don't need to stop at the service station. And you see where that left him, doesn't it? We find ourselves in a similar boat. We're worked up and we're worn down because we refuse to use the means Christ has provided. We think we can bear the load. I love our own catechism. It says, you know, how do we escape the wrath and curse of God due to us for sin? And how do you bear the load? And it says, well, you need faith and repentance. And we think, yes, I got that. I can go on my merry little way. But it adds one more. And the diligent use of all the outward means Christ uses to communicate his benefits to us. Let me rephrase that. The diligent use of all the filling stations Christ provides for us. This church, this session in diaconate, worship, Lord's Supper, baptism, prayer, the word, the diligent use of these things. God has given them to us so that we can bear the load. There's a new trend in Christianity since COVID that says, "I don't need the church. I'm just fine on my own." This is a Messiah complex. Jesus did not die on a cross to make you a little M Messiah. Moses couldn't do it, and neither could we. Do you know what happens to Christians who try to bear the load alone? They simply do not grow. In the current situation, Israel's height is only as high as Moses can lift them. And Moses is one man. He can only lift them so far. As the old saying goes, don't worry about the mule, just load the wagon. After a while, you keep loading the wagon and you kill the mule. We have to share the load. This is why Jethro says, Moses, find able men. Now I want you to look at ourselves. We battle sin and temptation. We need godly peers to hold us accountable. And the warp and woof of life, we need the prayer and support of others. Even basic necessities, the wisdom in parenting children, the assistance when we grow old, when we get down on our and physical infirmities and life hits us hard and we need financial and physical assistance. God cares for these things. When Jesus died on the cross, he did much more than save us. He ascended on high and gave gifts to men. And he gave those gifts in the form of leaders. Elders are much more than men who make decisions. Deacons are much more than the men who take care of the property. If you look back to John Lafayette Gerardo, he was a Southern Presbyterian minister in the largest African-American congregation in Charleston, the largest congregation in Charleston. Do you know what the elders did? They served and shepherded the souls of every sick individual in that church. And the deacons made sure their needs were met both physically and financially. Because that's what elders and deacons do. They come alongside us like the beams in this building to bear us up. Christ cares for us, body and soul. And he sends able men to encourage, to equip, and to empower us. He cares for us. He sends people to share the load. Now let's rehearse this for a minute. We have a load to bear. In every season of life, you will have a load. You will never be without one. If you thought you would, spoiler alert, it will always be there. But God sends the church to share that load. Now, who is it within the church that shares the load? Jethro tells Moses to find able men. And I want to issue a little caveat here. We're going to vote on an elder who's currently a deacon. That means we're going to need a deacon, or two, or five. We need godly men. I want to speak to the men for a minute, and there's a reason why. Sitting in the very back, I have a six-year-old little girl. And when I'm brave, I like to read WLBT. And I see all the horrible things going on in this world. And I see the world she's going to have to walk into. I don't say, well, I sure hope we get some better police funding. I don't say, I hope they improve the educational system around here. No. I ask, where have the godly men gone? Where have the godly men gone? Righteousness, justice will never be promoted until we can find and promote godly men in our churches and in our families and in our communities. So let's ask a very simple question. What is a godly man? Jethro gives us a few things. He says, first, a godly man is one who is a man of the word, a man who fears God. In Moses' context, it was one who was committed to the teachings of Moses. For us, it's one committed to the teaching of the Bible. John Calvin says that under the term fear of God comprehends all of religion. Now, that word religion is peculiar. Religion comes from a Latin word that means to bind or to commit oneself to. That tells me that everyone in this world is religious because we're all committed to something. The question is, what are we committed to? A godly man is committed to the Word of God. You go home, you work all day, you unhitch your 16-foot trailer, And what do most men do? Before they jack it up, they put a block. They want a firm foundation to lift up that trailer. In the same way, the church has many burdens to which we bear under her umbrella. We need godly men with a firm foundation, a life built upon the Word. Where are the men whose lives are built upon the Word of God? Where are the godly men who can share the load? We need a godly man who fears God, but we need a godly man of integrity. Jethro says it's a trustworthy man who does not accept a bribe, a man of integrity. Charles Stanley tells this story of these Saxon warriors who were baptized by immersion, except for their right arm. That was their fighting arm. They did not want to submit that to the reign of Christ. That is their weakest link, the place where they have no integrity. That is where they are susceptible to a bribe. Now let me give you a definition. A bribe is not simply money. Bribes are influence peddling involving status, stuff, and self-promotion. Influence peddling. I know many men who will run their mouth because it knows it'll make them the center of attention. It'll get them status. I know many men who will serve because it will promote their ranks in the community. These are forms of bribes just as much as if I slipped a 20 under the pew. It's influence peddling. I ask you, where is your weakest link? Where do you have a lack of integrity? If you can't answer that question, ask your spouse. If you're not married, well, what makes you throw a hissy fit the quickest? I promise you, that's the place where you are most easily bribed. Are you submitting these things to Christ? Where are the godly men of integrity? Where are the men who can share the load? Lastly, a godly man must be a man of the Word, a man of integrity, and a man of humility. I want you to notice something amazing. Here's Moses, son of a prince, leader of a nation that just punched Egypt right in the kisser. Moses listened to his father-in-law. That's a miracle. That's humility. He is a humble man because Moses recognized his limitations. Humility doesn't mean you let people walk all over you. It means you know your limits. But more than that, humility isn't just knowing your limits. It's being willing to help anyone, anytime, anywhere. The body cannot grow if it's constantly battling inflammation. We need men who will share the load with anyone, who will stoop to the lowest ranks of society if needed, to share the load through reconciling, through discipleship, through service. I don't need point and tell men. We don't need men who can talk the talk. We need men who get their hands dirty. Where are the godly men built for humility? Where are the men who can share the load? I close with this. Drive by my office, and there's these four big old pillars, okay? If I take out one of those pillars, what's the roof going to do? It's going to sag a little. Do any of y'all want to come hang out under a sagging roof? I don't think so. We need pillars to support the weight of this church. On May 16th, we will be electing or voting for one. But we need more than one. If I wanted to expand that porch, let's say I wanted a wraparound porch, you know what I'm going to need? More pillars. If this church is going to grow, if we're going to promote the gospel in this place and around the world, We need godly men to rise up and to share that load. Is that you? Who will rise up to fill this void as we journey through this wilderness between here and a heavenly city? God has provided this church, these people, to bear that load. The ones who are doing it, Clark, Lee, Mac, Robert, pray for them. But second, pray for more. Pray for more. And when you find yourself crushed by the burdens of this life, do more than pray for them. Call them. This church exists to bear your burdens with you, physical and spiritual. Pick up the phone and call. Do not bear your burden alone. Share the load. Let us pray. Gracious Father, thank you that in your weakness, you have established your church to strengthen us. You're a kind, compassionate, caring Father. And may this body of believers bear the load for one another. And may we bear the load for those struggling in this world that do not know Christ. May you bring them under our umbrella. May we lift them up. Father, we ask these things in Christ's name.